हेलो फ्रेंड्स, वेलकम बैक टू द थर्ड पार्ट ऑफ द टॉपिक एनवायरमेंटल कंजर्वेशन एंड डिजास्टर मैनेजमेंट। वेर प्रीवियसली वी आर स्टडिंग अबाउट व्हाट इज एनवायरमेंट, व्हाट इज एनवायरमेंटल स्टडीज, व्हाट इज एनवायरमेंटल साइंस, ऑल दीज थिंग्स। एंड इन दिस लेक्चर दैट इज इन द थर्ड पार्ट ऑफ दिस मॉड्यूल विल स्टार्ट विद फूड चेन एंड फूड वेब। व्हाट डू यू मीन बाई फूड चेन एंड फूड वेब? ऑल लिविंग ऑर्गेनिजम्स दैट इज प्लांट्स एंड एनिमल्स मस्ट ईट सम टाइप ऑफ फूड फॉर सर्वाइवल। This is but obvious that for survival, every one of us needs some food to generate energy in ourselves. Plants makes their own food through process called photosynthesis. We have been learning this topic photosynthesis since our childhood. This is the process by which plants make their own food by using sunlight. Here it is explained in detail. Using the energy from sun, water and carbon dioxide from the atmosphere and nutrients, they chemically make their own food. So we can say that plants are the organisms which create energy within themselves. Since they make or produce their own food, they are called producers. In short, we can say that plants are the producers of what? Of energy within themselves. If we consider our example, we as a human being are not able to generate our own energy. We acquire it from plants or animals. So based on this, we'll understand this figure later on, but at first we'll continue with the food chain theory. Organisms which do not create their own food must eat either plants or animals. They are called consumers. As I explained, if we consider our example, we are the consumers. We are not able to generate energy by ourselves. We need to rely on the plants or other animals. Human being is just one example of consumers. Some animals get their energy from eating plants, while other animals get energy indirectly from plants by eating other animals that already ate the plants. So as we all know that energy cannot be created nor be destroyed, it can only be transferred from one form to another. So here, energy which was generated by plants, it gets transferred to the animals who eats the plant. This is the indirect form of transfer of energy. So now we can say that the energy has been transferred to the consumers. Animals that eat only plants are called herbivores. So only the plants eating animals is called herbivores. And animals that eat both plants and other animals are called omnivores. So we as a social animal, we can consider ourselves as omnivores. And the animals that eat only other animals are called carnivores. And some animals eat only dead and decaying materials and are called decomposers. So there are few animals who eat only dead and decaying materials if found. They are known as decomposers. Now I'll give example of each of this. At first, the examples of these consumers are all the breeds of the plant. All the plants are able to generate energy by themselves. Then the example of these herbivores, that is animals that only eat plants, are deer, cattle, elephants, horses, rabbit, giraffe, zebra. All these animals eat only plants and acquire energy from it. Then examples of these omnivores are bears, humans, birds, insects, dog, fish, squirrel, pigs, chicken and many more. These all are omnivores who may be dependent on both plants and animals. Then we have animals who eat only other animals are carnivores. For example, lion, tiger, bear, cheetah, wolves, hyena, leopard, all these are carnivores, or we can say carnivorous animals. And some animals eat only dead and decaying materials and are called decomposers. So examples of this decomposer may be insects, bacteria, fungi, snails, earthworm, beetles. All these are decomposers who eat only decaying and dead materials if found anywhere in the grass. So these were the examples based on the consumers, herbivorous, omnivorous, carnivorous animals and decomposers. So now we'll try and understand this figure. This is the chain of food, or we can say a cycle for the transfer of energy. Here plants acquire energy from sunlight, and by the process of photosynthesis it generates its own energy. And for example, a grasshopper which eats the plants and generates energy within themselves, and the mice eats the grasshopper and again transfers the energy. So these are the indirect source of transfer of energy. And again, the snake eats this mice, then eagle eats the snake, then when the hawk dies, fungi breaks the bodies down and turns them into nutrients. Now this gets converted to nutrients by the process of decomposition, and this nutrients in the form of mushroom we are getting here. on ground again. The nutrients along with the sun and water cause the grass to grow. Then again this grasshopper eats this grass. In this way the entire cycle gets completed and it goes on. This is known as food chain. But we are having some technical terms to learn over here. In marine food web, special producers are found, which means plants which are under water. They are also able to produce the energy by themselves. They are tiny microscopic plants. See here, they are not huge plants as seen on the land. These are known as phytoplankton. Since water is the home for these special tiny plants, it is also the home for tiny microscopic animals called zooplankton. So also there are animals available under water who eats this phytoplankton, that is plants, microscopic plants under water. So now we are going through the entire food chain under water. And of course zooplankton eats phytoplankton, yes, it is obvious, for the transfer of energy and completion of the food chain or the cycle of transfer of energy. Sometimes zooplankton and phytoplankton are collectively referred to as plankton. So these both are collectively may be known as plankton. Now we'll move towards the definition of the food chain. Food chains show the relationship between producers, consumers and decomposers, showing who eats whom with arrows. So this is the complete food chain, as we saw the example of this. Sunlight, plants, grasshopper, mice, snake, eagle, hawk, grass and this complete cycle. So again, repeating the definition of the food chain, it shows the relationship between producers, consumers and decomposers, showing who eats whom by arrows. This is food chain. Moving further, the arrow shows the movement of the energy through the food chain. How the energy gets transferred in the food chain, these arrows show that. For example, in the food chain shown below, the small fish, that is silverside, gets its energy by eating the plankton, and the large fish, bluefish, gets energy by eating the small fish. Finally, the bacteria eats the fish after it dies, getting its energy from the large fish. The bacteria also turns nutrients back to the environment for the use by the phytoplankton. So everything can be understood from this chart or cycle. Phytoplankton transfers the energy to zooplankton as they eat them. Zooplankton acquires energy from the phytoplankton by eating them. Again, silverside may directly obtain the energy from phytoplankton or may be obtaining from zooplankton. So in this way, energy gets transferred from phytoplankton to zooplankton and zooplankton to silverside. Again, bluefish may eat the silverside and acquire energy. Then when this bluefish dies, this bacteria again eats that bluefish as they are decomposers. This bacteria again transfers the nutrients back to the environment and grow the grass, which may be eaten by phytoplankton. Again, the bacteria returns nutrients back to the environment for the use of phytoplankton. In this way, the cycle continues and life goes on the earth. So this is what the food chain is. I have explained you with the example and with this transfer of energy. Then, thus the food chain becomes the complete circle. Animals may eat more than one type of food. They may eat many different types of plants and many different animals. This makes everything more complicated and food chain becomes a food web. So again, explaining the first figure, what I showed you. Here, the plants acquire energy from the sunlight by the process of photosynthesis, that is common process, and it goes on repeating. This grasshopper eats the grass. But it is not so that grasshopper only eats the plants. Sometimes grasshopper even eats the other insects. Similarly, this mice does not every time eat only the grasshopper. There are many other insects and animals which this mice may eat. And the snake may be eating numerous other food for acquiring the energy. Similarly, all the sources may have some other different source to acquire the energy. This makes our food chain complicated. We cannot show it very easily with the arrows. So it becomes a food web. This makes everything more complicated and the food chain becomes a food web. Here we can see that this food chain is very complicated with numerous arrows. We cannot easily identify who eats whom. And thus it becomes a food web. So we can say that food web is very complicated as compared to that of the food chain. Moving further, for food web, a food web is made up of interconnected food chains. So by connecting numerous food chain, we can form a food web, but it may not be very easy for us to identify who eats whom and how the energy gets transferred. This is the main thing. Most communities include various populations of producer organisms, which are eaten by any number of consumer population. See here, there are many consumers, but producer as plants are only one. See here, there are many consumer population, that is, there are many consumers animals who may eat different species of the plant. And if you consider, the green crab for example is a consumer as well as decomposer. See, the crab will eat dead things or living things if they can catch them. So these type of animals makes the food chain complicated, so it is known as food web. And moving further, here is a typical example of a food web where energy starts to transform from this bottom part to top part. It becomes very complicated for us to determine how and how much energy gets transferred from one to another, but it is but obvious that this cycle has to be completed so that life goes on. Moving further, a secondary consumer may also eat any number of primary consumers or producers. So it is not that if it is a secondary consumer, it does not eat grass or does not acquire energy from plants. It may eat any number of primary consumers or producers. So it can even eat producers, that is plants. It is possible. These are the omnivores which I just gave the examples. This becomes non-linear set of interactions which shows the complex flow of energy in nature. So as we show here, this is a very complex flow of energy in our nature. In a food web, nutrients are recycled in the end by decomposers. But at last, it does not matter how complicated our food web is. Nutrients are recycled by decomposer at the end. Animals like shrimp and crabs can break the materials down to detritus. Then bacteria reduce the detritus to nutrients. That is, shrimps and crab may break the material, all the materials, that is dead and decaying materials we are right now talking about, into detritus, that is debris, small parts. Then bacteria reduces this detritus or debris into nutrients, and again the plant grows. Decomposers work at every level, setting free nutrients that form an essential part of the total food web. Now we have understood that if any of the portion of this food web or food chain breaks due to any reason, that may be change in the temperature in the atmosphere or any other weather condition, if changes, then our cycle of chain would break, and our food web may also change, as it has already changed, because millions of years ago there used to be dinosaurs and their food chain used to be entirely different. And it is possible that millions of years from now, even the species of plants, animals and even humans may change. So friends, this is all for today, and thank you for watching.